a focus on a broad dependent variable, which is to try to understand the extraordinary expansion of organization in the modern world. I'll spell out that, but much of it is obvious, that a few decades ago, in every sector and in every country, there was a lot less organization, formal organization, than there is now. And the question is why? More realist explanations don't work very well. First of all, the spread of organization is too widespread. I'll talk about that. And it vastly extends beyond explanatory variables like increases in social complexity or something, which play a causal role. But not. So, in my own view, we need to look at broader cultural changes as creating the grounds on which organizations spring up and spread. And I think that in this field, such variables are given less attention than they should be. Most people in the field of organizations, unfortunately, believe in them. They don't only study them, but there's a kind of faith. If you work in a business school, you have to at least pretend to have that faith. There's no other alternative. That means you take for granted the cultural grounds and restrict yourself to a rather narrower set of explanatory variables, which don't, in this situation, work. I obviously take a broader view and a cultural view. I represent, the new institutionalisms. But now, in recent decades, everybody is an institutionalist. And it covers a very wide ground, and so I need to make a couple of distinctions. And just very briefly, this is a two-minute lecture on modern organization theory. The basic target is to explain wider macro controls over the modern actor in some fashion. Well, the old institutionalisms, by the way, were also institutional, but didn't conceive the units under control as actors. I'm coming to that. They conceived of them as, for example, peasants or persons, but not, they weren't promoted to actorhood. So then you get the new institutionalisms, the hardline realisms, in which the actors are prior and fixed, and the institutional system is very simple, property rights or something, or sovereignty at Westphalia. And then you have various resource dependence models, network models, which imagine, again, that the actors are pretty fixed and the institutional structure is fairly limited and certainly not cultural in character. It's a series of networks carrying power. And then you have the famous paper of DiMaggio and Powell, which is partly about these more realist notions, that is, organizations spring up as creatures of the coercive power of the state or the normative authority of the professions. And those things create the influence these actors, these organizations, but they still have a good deal of autonomous existence in their own right. They are influenced by the state or by the professions. And then DiMaggio and Powell committed rather successfully the sin of an additional idea. They called it mimetic isomorphism, in which that organizations don't decide to do, they just do it. There are rules. So you get, now these are situations in which the actor is a different kind of creature. He's a theatrical actor enacting scripts of various kinds, which raises the question, who writes the scripts? Maybe, so you have two uses of the word actor, one in which implies this is a bounded, purposive, self-contained unit, and the other of which implies it's a theatrical entity enacting cultural scripts. This point of view, of course, classically goes back to Berger and Luckman, or my own paper that Marie-Laure referred to with Brian Rowan and other documents, constructions. Obviously, in our field, there is some tension here. I put a red line here, precisely between DiMaggio and Powell's coercive and normative isomorphisms and the mimetic isomorphism, because they're radically different pictures of the nature of the actor under control. This is a matter of some tension, more in American thought than in European thought. The Europeans never took quite seriously the idea that the individual actor is a John Wayne. They don't really believe in John Wayne the same way they should. The Americans do, and that gives a problem with any line of theory that treats the actor as constructed and derivative. There's a long history there, and it goes on continuously. In America, you gain points by using these lines of thought, but you come under normative criticism for doing so. So you have to, it's a trade-off situation. How sinful are you willing to be in order to be interesting and successful? People make different decisions, and their decisions change over time. Well, that's the end of, I'm not really, I obviously represent this line of thought. My point here is that these more constructivist lines of thought in which the actors are being constructed are sort of crucial to explaining cultural effects on the rise of modern organization, which that's in the background of what I'm talking about. Well, everything in the world that my research focuses on, and in the world under discussion here, that is the very rapid explosion of organization around the world, those events start after World War II. There are longer, earlier trajectories, but it becomes exponential after World War II. It changes character, and you need to understand why, the circumstances of the time. It's hard. There are many variables, many things in the world changed at the macro level, and you have to pull that together for my purposes in some sort of simplifying argument. One big change was a radical increase in perceived, and to some extent actual, globalization and interdependence. Nuclear war possibilities, other military conflicts, a Cold War. Economic exchange, although that is exaggerated. I mean, in the literature, globalization is often seen as a kind of economic phenomenon, where it's much broader than that. Political, military, social, fairly high levels of migration, cultural communication, and so on. And very interdependent. And everybody saw that. Most dramatically, they saw it here in Europe, which had experienced 50 years of disaster in a situation of high interdependence and low control over it. And they knew they had to do something different. But this was really a world-level effect. Marie-Laure's own first book describes the situation of the import of various more macro-level theory into the notions of a European society. And that's gone on ever since. But a second point would be, beyond interdependence, everybody knew there was no possibility of a state. The traditional Western solution to problems of interdependence and coordination is some kind of state. You couldn't have a world state. It was very clear. The fantasies of the world state before World War I pretty much disappeared. So the organizational solution is not available, even in Europe. Everybody knew you couldn't have a state in Europe, too. And of course, the European Union is not a state. It's some other kind of polity. And the first thing you say about it, you don't brag about it as a state. You say it's a failure. And people have been saying that for the last 50, 60 years. Every time I come to Europe, it's amazing. They used to say, it was an interesting fantasy, but it's a failure. That's how you talk about it, which means it's not a state. You can't imagine it that way. Statelessness is a second variable, independent variable. Third, the existing ontological structure of the world, politically, the nation-state system, was in very great disrepute, more than you now realize. That is the nationalist vision before World War II and World War I. Charismatic national states rooted in race, religion sometimes, history, dramatized as the basis of action. You people are mostly very young. You get younger every year. But you may not remember a time when the only legitimate basis to kill someone was on behalf of your nation state. Now people do so. My students would not do that anymore, though they might kill on behalf of redwood trees or something. But they wouldn't. It's broken down. The charismatic sense that this is the entity. So the one structure they had broke down. They couldn't build a similar structure on a more macro level. And they perceived everywhere growth and interdependence. Well, the theorist here who writes about this historically is de Tocqueville. In democracy, especially in democracy in America, but also elsewhere. And he understood that you can have a polity that wasn't built around a center of an organizational center of authority, but that would then create other forms of collective organization and social control that would operate differently. And in democracy in America, he spelled out how that worked. And he made the point that, you can use religious ideas as bases of solidarity. That hasn't worked very well in the world. Religion is mostly used in the world as a basis of fragmentation. But you have other forms of cognitive structure analogous to religion. And you have in the post-World War II world, astoundingly, an unexplained dramatic expansion of science, and we have studied that. Here are just a few indicators from our book, but science expands in amount, in the topics covered. For example, there used to not be much science about children. Now there's lots of it. 10 different departments of a university might have a course on children. And whenever you have a professor talking about children and doing science about children, you increase the prospect of organization, either new organizations dealing with childhood, so protecting them, doing something to them, or old ones extending their jurisdiction to manage some aspect of childhood. Maybe your students at ESSEC will go off in the world and, work for a candy company with an articulate doctrine how to influence 8-year-old kids to ruin their teeth. Or maybe one of your students will go to work for a dental health international organization to teach the children not to do that. But either way, it's rationalized, organized, and there are structures that were not there before. Organizational structures. My own focus, and what is important for this talk, is the authority of science. Which is the least. There are other explanations of the expansion of scientific activity, although they're not all that good. But nobody can explain very well the authority. Why is everybody else listening? The theory of that would require that you assume the scientists are very intelligent and everyone else is an idiot. And this, if for those of us who know science, this is not reasonable. So here's an indicator. Countries, the units of analysis are countries. Time period here, 1950 goes off. And suddenly in the world, there are ministers of science. In 100 and some countries have a minister of science. They didn't do that in the good old days. One theory is that it's functional, but No great capitalist needs to know if there's ice on a moon of Saturn. And no head of state needs to know if there are planets circling around some distant star, or most recently two stars, a unique planet. And we have spent tens of billions of dollars to find that out. Functional? No. I mean, it's most scientific activity is historically, and the historians of science understand that, useless. Or in any immediate sense, it has effects, but it's certainly useless. It's better to think of a science as a cosmology of the post-World War II system. That's what Tocqueville was suggesting. The use of a shared knowledge system as a religious system, providing a cognitive frame within which responsible actors can cooperate, be reasonable, can act in coordination. That's one element of the culture, the transformation of reality into a universalized, scientized enterprise. Empirically, the biggest expansions of science are not the hard sciences, but the humanities. Here's from a paper two of my collaborators did. This is enrollments standardized at 100% for each period in a rapidly expanding higher education system. What fields do they study? The flat lines are the sciences. The rising line is us. And who we're killing off are the humanities, rooted in local cultures, national cultures, regional cultures, religious cultures, and so on. And we're the growth curve here. Which makes sense after World War II, since many of the problems and the uncertainties that they imagined in the world were, in fact, social in character. Other data come from at the faculty level from other collaborators of mine. This is university faculty in the 20th century. And it's not nearly as good a database as the other one, but it's interesting. The top line is sciences. The rising line is us. And the declining line, the humanities. Just to make the point clear, I calculate from their data the ratio of history professors to social science professors. We're really killing them off. We're getting rid of history. And after we tried to get rid of race, and we've marginalized religion, so science becomes very important, and social science. This is very widespread. So we think of science as providing a kind of cosmology here for an expanding world order.
Yeah. Just to clarify, do you include economics and business schools into social sciences?
Yeah. This was done in America. You know, in America, they think of economics as a social science, which is probably a mistake.
But if you exclude economics, we'll get the same, I think.
Yes. Their findings hold for every specific social science and more strongly for applied social science, as with the explosion of business schools, for example. But everyone declined. And their finding in the humanities, everyone declined. Every social science grows as a relative fraction of both faculty and, I think, students, but faculty for sure. It's consistent. Some decline a little more. Anthropology among social science doesn't do very well. It grows, but not so well, because it celebrates a world in which there were distinctive cultures and stuff. And the West doesn't have that. Remember, the modern world is a rational organizational system, and the anthropologists have trouble. The world they study disappears. Is that okay? Yeah, Bruce, okay. Well, that's the rationalized structure within which organizations obviously grow and prosper. A world in which these kinds of rationalized analyses hold, it's very striking. The ontology of this system also changes. As I mentioned, the nation state loses its charisma and all the structures linked to it. Local family systems decline in legitimacy. I mean, most of you don't have children, but when you have them, you're not supposed to beat them anymore. I mean, they have rights in the state, in the globe, in the world. What a tragedy. The the religious groups lose status, communities lose status, ethnic traditions lose status, ethnic nationalism loses status. What gains is the individual as a fundamental unit directly linked to the cosmos. So we have natural law producing science and natural law producing the awareness of the individual, celebrated among other places in modern economics, for example. I meant to show you just, this is now at the secondary school level, and this is data from on curricula, how much time in the primary and lower secondary level is spent on various subjects. And I would just call your attention to the decline of history. These are two comparisons with different, showing the same effect. And the rise of bastard sociology called social studies. I mean, the difference is in history there are good guys and bad guys and good and evil on a collective level. In social studies, it's everybody's a nice guy. There are no bad guys. And everybody's fundamentally similar. Whereas in history, everybody's fundamentally different. So you can have the child study a chapter on a child in ancient Egypt, and he turns out to have a mom and dad just like he does, you know, we do, like that. And then suddenly shift to India, or our own prehistoric past, all cleaned up, everybody a nice guy. Order is depicted. I just wanted to show you that. But on to the individual. A student at Emory finished his dissertation, and he counted international instruments celebrating human rights over the 20th century. And here they take off after World War II. Cumulative rights that are declared in various instruments. Hundreds of instruments, expanding sets of rights, right? A right to education, a right to choose your own religion, your own cultural choice, your own language, all kinds of rights. They expand all the time. The number of rights expand. He also classifies groups, and of course they expand too. Women, children, old people, gay and lesbian people, handicapped people, in international instruments, indigenous people. He notes that all the treaties that mention rights treat them as rights of the individual, not any corporate group. It's not that women as a corporate group have the right. In some places they do, but in the world norms, that's not the way it's written. An individual who is a woman has the rights of equality. The only exception, he says, are indigenous people who sometimes have in the treaties corporate rights. They are equivalent to nations in some of the conceptions. It's a minor point. The major point is that the individual is everything. So rights expand, and then powers expand. These individuals are seen as much more dynamic, capable of real purpose, agendas, rational, and they are responsible. So here are the different actors he finds in world society who are responsible to maintain human rights, their own and other people's, to advocate. It's not the good old days where the church did it, or the more recent old days where the state did it. Now, they do it themselves, in principle. I don't recommend you try it in practice, but that's another issue. Rights expand, powers expand. And then in the modern world, another enormous expansion and another unpredicted one was the enormous growth in higher education, but in education generally, which becomes a human right, which expands from a minority of the human population at the mass level to almost everybody gets some education now. It's a human right, also a human obligation. It's strange, you have the right as a human being in the modern world to spend 10 years of your life in a compulsory prison of mass. It's a strange combination, but it captures the sense of the modern world. And secondary education expands even more, and then elite education. Here's world students. And this is a very slow growth up until the war, and then explosion. So 20% of a cohort in the world or more now are enrolled in higher education. And probably 30% get some higher education, post-secondary academic education. It's astonishing. Nobody predicted it. Represents a real change. And it occurs everywhere. This is one of those, all these changes occur at least normatively everywhere, and in this case, in actual enrollment. So here I tabulate countries. I've done this much more sophisticated with real multivariate analyses of the factors that affect it, but I don't want to waste time here. There's different regions of the world in the world class structure. Well, yeah, the West grows, but all the others grow too. In Africa, the growth rate, if I had this on semi-logarithmic paper, the growth rate is very similar everywhere. They're all expanding as rapidly as they can during this whole period. Interestingly, the one exception is this solid line, and that's the communists. The communists in around 1970 understood that there's an inconsistency between expanded liberal individualism and the rights of the and powers of the class, the party of the working class, and the working class itself. And every communist country tried to stop it, some more, some less successfully. But communism went away. And those countries are indistinguishable from the rest of it. It's amazing. Well, in order to, what's obviously involved is a real decline in a model of society worldwide. And the decline can be said quite simply in up until the 50s, the conception of society was national society, and it was conceived of as a rather closed system. And you needed education to fit people into the closed system. And too much education is a disaster. Over-education, a word that has disappeared. That was a chronic, in the field of sociology studying this, this was agreed as axiomatic. Here by Raymond Boudon, elsewhere by other intellectuals in America, Joseph Ben David, that an orderly modern society, you would control the expansion of higher education, which give access to the elites. Right? And the only places where it would break down was if the state was too weak. And that was why it expanded too much in America. It was an American exceptionalism story and a negative story, that educational inflation took off in America because the states were too weak to stop it, whereas the French state can stop anything, and does. Well, that's broken down. That was the theory until the 70s. And this expansion was treated as an anomaly. To give you a feeling for the old one, I found an article that captures how guys thought in the 1920s. Here's a German minister of education in 1930 from the New York Times. The steadily rising tide of engineering students in German universities with consequent overcrowding in the engineering profession, imagine that, has moved the German General Federation of German Industries and some other groups to issue a public warning about a sterile, educated proletariat. It's being produced without a chance at gainful occupation while millions are wasted on its training. This is basically us, right? That he's talking about. And we are a problem. In German thinking, the problem from the left-wing point of view is that we represent a breakdown of class consciousness if everybody wants social mobility. From a right-wing point of view, it's worse. It's Anomie, which is the worst thing a German intellectual can think of. That is a breakdown of a normative order in which everything's under control. From the center, it's inefficiency, a waste. That was the perspective he took here. It's wasteful, but he also had hints that it's an anomie is involved too. He doesn't talk about the breakdown of class consciousness. Later, he knows who's at fault. It arises from an erroneous belief their diploma would help them gain and develop an income. The responsibility really rests on the parents, who, without informing themselves in authoritative quarters about academic prospects and possibilities, deem it their duty to make advanced studies possible for their sons and daughters. This evil is directly connected to the distorted value placed in Germany on going through the schools. That's not the way you write now, right? Obviously, this theory of a closed national society with an economy with some zero-sum properties, although growing, it's replaced by an open system concept, human capital, and later, human development theory. If you recall, human capital still had an idea that somebody would work, and that his work would be more valuable. But now we've gone to the knowledge society. He doesn't work anymore. He innovates, right? He entrepreneurs, whatever that is, things like that. That is it's really an open system. And of course, you know, you celebrate it at places like Stanford, I don't know, maybe here also. You have students who decide when they're graduating, I think I will be an entrepreneur. And you ask, what are you gonna make? And he said, well, we're meeting every week. We have a meeting where we discuss what product we might entrepreneur about or innovate about. Imagine what this guy would have thought of such a student in 1930. Well, okay. A changed model of society is involved, emphasizing personal development, the expansion of the individual, which involves this awareness by the individual of a rationalized environment. So it's quite, we do some stuff at the secondary school level. This is coded 500 textbooks from around the world for the last 40 years. And this is whether they stress the student as an active creator of action, as opposed to a student shutting up and learning something, right? And you get just dramatic changes. This is worldwide. And when you have controls for a region, it remains. These are worldwide changes. Yeah, it's all much more focused on an active picture of the student as creating his or her world. Get used to it. If you teach, you know, it's going to be like this. And it's normative, as educational ideology celebrates it more than the books do, even. Just one other example. Do they talk about human rights? Yeah. In the earlier period, very little. And then now, much more. Including the rights of the little bastard himself. Student rights. I mean, you know, this involves clearly an open system. A closed system school doesn't think that way. They don't want students thinking about rights and stuff. This is now represents a huge change. Well, so now you have the empowered person, and this is celebrated in our field linguistically. My friend and colleague Hokyu Huang did this table, and I love to show it. He looks at whether the rise of the word actor in the first place. In our discourse, three journals. Here it goes. What proportion of the articles refer to people as actors? Right? Now, Arthur Stinchcomb had made the point that an earlier organization theory of the before World War II and after rested on the assumption everybody had mass education. He noticed in his 1965 paper, I think he mentioned. Well, they became, the peasants, in other words, were reconceptualized as persons. And then you had an organization theory of the organization of these. Well, now, with higher education, they're now actors, which is a kind of, an actor is a person who's been to college, basically, and who is in tune with the laws of God in nature and social life, and is capable of action. It's 50% of the papers now, he found as of 2000. This is the ASR, the ASQ, the AJS. That's what he did. It would also occur in political science journals. Not so much, interestingly, in economics. They seem to assume it, but they don't use the word as much. I edited, with some other people, an issue of the Academy of Management Journal. Came out last December, I think. And we looked at 100 page papers. I looked at about 25 of them. Of the ones we accepted, the median one used the word actor 51 times. So as you work in your field and come in under pressure to publish in English language journals, that's a target, bear it in mind. I think they're not persons anymore, they're actors. It's a step up. And I assume you know not to call them peasants anymore. That we promoted them from anthropology to sociology, but now it's a broader thing. Okay. So you get now these by being. I should have mentioned other studies, which I do not show here, show that in mass and higher education curricula are quite homogeneous around the world. The same topics are studied. Organizational structure varies in tune with variations among national states in how they organize things. But the curricula, what they try to teach, not always effectively, but the intended curricula, are really quite homogeneous and quite modern. Standardized around the world and very scientized, and certainly celebrating, at least in principle, the empowered individual. Well, these people now, promoted to actorhood, are obviously able to form organizations. In the old days, there used to be bureaucracies derived from the state, and firms derived from private power. And the sovereignty lay with the state and the private power. And there were professions, and the sovereignty lay with the professions, and the school was a shadow organization controlled by a sovereign profession, hospital, like that. Now you have all these people. They can assemble, they're standardized, they are cleaned up, and they can form organizations. And this is a core point, the modern organization differs from the bureaucracy or the professional organization or the old family firm in that it is an actor with its own sovereignty, accountable, and a fairly rational one. So just like a university graduate, now we have a collection of them. It can have purposes of its own. It has decision-making, it does. Sovereignty, a control system, information system, irrationalized mapping of resources, clear definition of its boundary, in abstract. Yeah, it's an organized actor, which is the transformation. And it obviously rests on a whole variety of cultural assumptions that I've spent my time here emphasizing. Now, if you take this view, you can then explain a whole bunch of things. You can explain first why organization expands so much under these changed cultural conditions. Everybody everywhere can form these things right away. And they do. One of the things Harvard students do is form an organization, a nonprofit usually. Later they make the money. I worked for a while in Uganda, or no, in Southern Africa, but I read a paper on Uganda by a researcher there. He found 4,000 non-governmental organizations in Uganda. Later, I worked in the Republic of Georgia, where these things would have been illegal 10 years before, 15 years, most of them. Somebody found 3,500 in the little Republic of Georgia. Most of them are dead letters, I mean, but they, Anybody can do organization. The wider cultural order facilitates it. A second thing you can explain is why they're organizations and not bureaucracies. And indeed, I assume in ESSEC there's no course on bureaucracy anymore. This is France, and there's no course in bureaucracy. Wow. We call them organizations now. We stopped calling them bureaucracies in the 50s and 60s. And it represents a real change. Remember, organization rests on imperative authority, said Max Weber, right? Modern organization doesn't work that way. You don't have courses in how to, for your MBA students, how to exercise imperative authority. You know, carry a whip or something. I mean, this is not what you do. And indeed, they are not bureaucracies in the old sense. They are complex modern organizational systems, which we can talk about the definition of. A third thing you can explain is why they arise in all sectors. Traditional theory explains why they arise in sectors where there's high interdependence or a dramatic desire for state control, bureaucratic control. That generates organization. The state, the market. But no, in the modern world, organizations pop up everywhere. Schools become organizations. Universities become organizations. Hospitals become organizations. All kinds of nonprofit structures become organizations. And state agencies are at least in principle supposed to give up some of the bureaucratic dimensions and become accountable and responsible organizations. Firms, similar. So, the phenomenon occurs in all sectors where there is technical interdependence, where there is not. Where there's a demand for imperative control, where there is not. Maybe cultural theory explains that a little better. Then you can explain, in becoming actors, you understand that in becoming an actor, a person takes on all kinds of social identities and responsibilities. Right? He's not just self-interested. He is a citizen, or in the modern world, a human being, citizen of the world, which means he takes on many properties of actorhood that may be quite inefficient from the point of view of immediate technical action. He becomes a person and is supposed to develop as a person. Well, similarly, organizations devote enormous resources to being organizations. So the modern organization, yes, it has purposes and so on. Here we go. You know, and a control system and decision making and all that stuff. But it incorporates many other functions. As it stabilizes itself vis-a-vis an increasingly rationalized environment, it becomes analogous to a person. It incorporates functions that have very distant relation. My own university, for example, which is among universities quite an organization, it has all kinds of functionaries very weakly related to teaching and research. It has a guy who counts oak trees. My campus at Stanford is very large and has quite a lot of oak trees. But it is not intrinsic to the teaching and research function that you'd count them and keep an inventory. He does. Yeah. They have all kinds of people responsible for different components of the community, for a dramatically expanded picture of who the students and faculty are and what they might need, right? The members of the organization. And the most dramatic examples that concern the rise of the modern environment, and my university not only counts oak trees, but has a program to protect something called the tiger salamander, which is a small but precious salamander, and it's rare, and it may be endangered, and money and programs are required to protect that. So you have a program to do that. The great growth, which you all know, is in the reconstruction of the legitimacy of the persons here and the actorhood of the persons, and that is the HR function. Right? Very distantly related to productivity. Hard to defend in any rational sense. but quite elaborate models of hiring and promotion and protection and so on. Oh, you say it's required by law. Yes, that's the rationalized environment, which writes into law, hard law and soft law, all kinds of requirements of what an organization should look like if it is a nice actor. And so you have this enormous expansion of complexity. The point of these things is that none of these things can be seen as clearly related to the output of the enterprise or the goals of the enterprise. It's all opaque. So how do you deal with that? Well, one great answer is professionalization. These modern organizations are filled with professionals. And the people who handle, those of us who handle the most invisible functions are the most highly professionalized, legitimized by certificates and so on. And so an organization, a leader of an organization can in good faith say we spent extra money to hire a really good HR person. So his index of the virtue is that he spent more money because he has no way of knowing what a good HR person is. The functional relation there is obscure. And that's true of an enormous amount of structure in a modern organization. Now, it's held together by accounting, and that how do you establish a stable value system in a situation where you don't know what anybody is really contributing to the enterprise, and yet you need to have a clear story of yourself as a rational, modern enterprise. And here you have the dependence on hard and soft law, which says to be this kind of organization, you must have this kind of program, or you should have. Say you should have an ISO certificate or something. You don't, it isn't required in most countries. So you spend a few, you know, some money and do that, like that. You have no idea exactly what that contributes. So hard and soft law, that's one source. The other source, which I'd call your attention to, extraordinarily important, in the absence of organizational structure where people do things like that, real like work and accomplish immediate goals and things, the extraordinary importance of accounting. Since accounting can turn in a totally opaque relationship into a certain causal one, symbolically, and relate all these investments on all kinds of people into rational investments. This extends up to the national and world level. So those of you who have an income, it adds up to the budget of ESSEC, and that adds up to the French GDP, and you are by, not add up to European and world, right? You are by definition a good investment, or an investment, maybe not a good one, but an investment, right? By definition, you may be totally stoned, but you are an investment and it counts. So uncertainty is dramatically reduced. And the accounting systems of the world are dramatic examples of that. And they become increasingly important. As they stabilize, the accounting rules get linked to myths of functionality. So that in the American context, businessmen who would have resisted affirmative action pressures and pressures for diversity and employment, but came under legal pressure and normative pressure to do that, 20 years later, says Frank Dobbin, they all account this as efficient, an efficient activity. And they say that's why they did it. That's why they decided to do it. But they didn't decide to do it. It happened to them. And efficiency wasn't why. But the myths of functionality arise so that in the modern world, investment in, like, sociology is treated as an investment in a STEM field. That's an acronym for virtuous, especially virtuous investment in education. But when I do multiple regressions, more sociology or more social science in general is associated negatively with growth in the GDP. And I think there are people in this room who probably really help with that. It's astonishing. But it is all turned into a positive truth by a series of of cultural agreements reflecting widespread scientized understandings and pictures. So there's a lot of myth here. I'll just very quickly show you some data, just as from studies that I've been involved in, all of which show these curves. This is at the international level. Suddenly they are able to organize, and you get non-governmental organizations, a very rare form before World War II, routine now. My Stanford students sometimes say, when I graduate, I'm going to go work for an Ingo. Like that, as if those are real things. It's routine now. Then the governments themselves do the same thing. These are intergovernmental associations. Notice, 1950. Always. And then you get the transformation of the world economy into an organizational structure. This is somebody else's accounting of multinationals. Well, as you know, international trade hasn't increased that much. But much more of it occurs. It's big. It's routine. These things used to be thought of as dangerous, impossible, imperialist, all kinds of things. And they take off. This study finds 63,000. I saw another study with 80-some thousand. It's a routine form. It's amazing. The private profit ones, just as Tocqueville said, they do have the problem. At the world level, there's no regulation worth talking about, and so they have to legitimate themselves, just like Tocqueville's American businessmen. And they do it with some science and a lot of religion. And here's the religion. These are CSR initiatives worldwide, right? That's a kind of church that a multinational corporation goes to on Sunday, and it says it will be good about variables, which it will, in fact, violate on Monday. And they grow. The big ones are GRI and the Global Compact, but there are others. And then, of course, evaluation comes up. There are rankings of firms and how virtuous they are. Well, you get this mentality even in odd situations like the university, which now imagines itself as productive. Here I have a quote from the website of the University of Minnesota. The first sentence is the president saying he's a good guy and that, you know, traditional university president stuff. But then he shifts the second sentence. The new century demands new thinking. You're starting to think knowledge society or something. And we're on the route to becoming one of the top three public universities in the world, says he. This is the way they talk now. Every country I go to, they talk about being one of the top 100. Minnesota, one of the top three. Okay. And then they try to root it in some notion of the loyalty and the involvement and activity of his people, his citizens. But it reads kind of primitive. It's an audacious goal, we know, be part of it and experience the only university in the world that can call itself Minnesota. I think a better speechwriter has to do better than that. But my point here is, in the next slide, which is one of his henchpersons on his thing, and that is, what does he mean? Well, first of all, you'd understand right away, he thinks all the good public universities are in America. He doesn't know about Oxford or Cambridge or anything. So he's only thinking about America. And his criterion, and this is the modern system, if you don't produce something, how do we decide what the value of what you produce is? What do you cost? So cost becomes an indicator. So he uses as his core indicator the size, not of research output, but of research expenditures, budget. And Minnesota does fairly well, but not as well as some of the others. Then he lists the ones he's competing with. To an American, this is comical, he does not put on his list the one we all know is the best one, the University of California at Berkeley. Why? Because the way you rip off the maximum amount of public money to no very good end is to have a medical school. That does it. You know, there are a lot of old politicians and businessmen with cancer and stuff. I mean, it's just a totally successful thing to do. And these all have medical school and Berkeley doesn't. So it's kind of what. So this is going on. All kinds of organizations are doing ranking on a universalistic scale. Business schools, universities, firms. It's amazing, the explosion of universalistic judgments, assessing their actorhood in general. So I conclude with just one example from my own situation. My own university, which does many of these things, is very active in being progressive in these matters. face some new problems that come up in American society that get discussed, or old problems that get discussed, and they confront what to do, problems of social relations. And they make some new rules, policy, of uncertain effect. And they create new, a slightly new criteria for employing people and orienting them to the new world of the new rules to deal with this problem. So they hire better people, but they have to fix the old ones because the modern organization is made up of actors. It's an actor, it's made up of actors, and to fix things, you have to fix the actors. So they require the old actors to participate in a little bit of compulsory education. And here is my last achievement in the world of compulsory education. I will show you. As a result of it, I'm slightly more valuable since money was spent. It must have been valuable. It must add to the university budget and the national GDP and the world GDP, and you are all happier because of it. You may not know that, but you could think it through. So here is my last accomplishment here in the world of compulsory education. I'm very proud of this. Let me leave it at that. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Professor Meyer, this is fascinating, and I think it gives a very insightful and very broad picture of the world in which we're living. I was thinking at the same time, do you think also about the influence of the new media of communication or the internet into allowing groups, small groups, those that are becoming less important according to your very compelling theory? Isn't that an outcome where some groups can gather, gain a voice, maybe, I don't know.
I think those factors are causal factors that make for the consequences we're talking about. Yeah, it's easier to form an international organization or a local one. But I'm calling attention to the sense it is also more legitimate. That is, I'm calling attention to the cultural side. But I agree with you, the straight technical side, meaning expanded communication opportunities, both internal and external to any organization, yeah, play a causal role here. It's just very hard to disentangle those things. The one qualification I'd mentioned on the straight effect of technology, even if you go to national contexts where the technology penetrates weakly, you still get this more generalized expansion, maybe not as much. And it's hard to do multivariate analyses that separate the technical communication side from the cultural side that facilitates the communication. It's hard to, but I think you're quite right. And we have conspicuous examples where internal to an organization, some sort of internet communication arises and a group can form that would not have formed in a previous period. I think you're right about that. But there's legitimacy. I don't know. In my university, just an example quickly, you know, it used to be there were people called secretaries. And many of them liked cats. And my university has quite a lot of cats that run around. And they used to feed the damn things at night, leave out some milk, which they're not supposed to do, but nobody could stop it. Well, that always went on. But now there's more legitimacy. They're not called secretaries anymore. They're called administrative assistants. They have a little more education and more confidence. And there's the wider animal rights movement. And they are much more aggressive. They organize on defense of the feral cats and on defense of the raccoons. And one of the crises my wife experienced when she worked managing a dorm was a raccoon bit a dog of a student. But the animal rights people say the raccoons have rights to be there, more than we do. But the dog was the seeing eye dog of a blind student. And a whole other set of rights come in. So now we have the confrontation between the Raccoon Protection League and the Disability Protection League. So crisis, that kind of thing you get in the old days, you can't imagine that happening that way. But I guess it's routine. Yeah. But that, you know, isolating the cultural side from the closely related communication. The kind of data I work with doesn't permit me to do that. And my main mission is to call attention to the importance of the cultural changes. That's, you know, that's my agenda here. Yeah, sure.
An easy question to formulate. So I was thinking that diversity in general in the modern discourse, political discourse, is positively perceived. Diversity in biodiversity,
yeah.
In human diversity in organizations.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
But diversity of norms and values, social diversity, is completely negatively judged, meaning that in political discourse, politicians push for globalization of human rights, uh-huh. Uniform, any types of rights,
yeah.
And rules.
Yeah.
How come, I mean, there is this big break between pushing for more diversity on many other fronts,
yeah.
As a way of something that creates value for human society,
yeah.
And accepting uniformity of norms and rules throughout the world as a normative positive thing?
That's a pretty serious issue. They do value, within a legitimating frame, cultural diversity. And so on. That's espoused. The right to choose your own religion as long as you don't hurt anybody. And the children in school are taught, you know, the virtues of diversity. And you, but it's they clean it up. You can't be intolerant of others. You can't violate human rights. You can't. No ethnic group worth talking about defends its cultural rights by saying, our cultural principle is we go home and we beat the hell out of our wives. They may do that. But no, they don't. They clean that up. They turn into nice guys. And we legitimate them on tame issues. Language is not so tame always. Cultural material, but as long as it doesn't, we don't want anybody making cultural claims on controlling the nation's banking system. Right? I come from this ethnic group. We know how to handle money really well. We'll handle the money. You don't try that. Right? So you clean things up. So you celebrate diversity, but within a legitimating frame. A good book on this is on female circumcision by Elizabeth Boyle, where the tension arises between the legitimate rights of ethnic groups in East Africa and a wider world system which stresses the individual rights of the girls and women. And she discusses that. There's an attack on her on normative grounds. She doesn't take a normative position, but a well-known American developmental anthropologist attacks her for not properly respecting complete cultural diversity. His name is Richard Schwader, and he does it in the newsletter or house organ of the Law and Society organization. I could find it for you, where he attacks her for not being sufficiently respectful of the rights. But then in order to defend the rights of tribal groups to do female circumcision, he has to downplay the medical and personal costs involved and say, well, it's not so bad after all, and you could do it with a clean razor blade instead of, you know, you'd be familiar with the whole thing. And that those arguments are going on all the time. You know, in France over the headscarf, you know, just everywhere where you have that kind of battle. But all the systems celebrate some form of choice and diversity, optional behavior on the part of the person. And at the same time, he has to be a nice person. It's amazing to watch. But the same thing occurs at the organizational level too, right? Where you could carry out those same issues organizationally. And it comes up. Well, does my brother used to manage some colleges of a religious denomination. And he thought it was important to hire faculty members who reflected the values of that denomination. But in American law, that doesn't go well. He has to write these tortured advertisements. I mean, he's running a college with a sectarian tradition of 400 years, right? Distinctive, Mennonite. and he's got to formulate the ad. You could imagine how tortured it reads. Yeah. And I think it's going on all the time. These boundaries. Resolution is very often scientific, you know, where you draw the boundary. Yeah. Other issues, questions? Yeah, go.
I have a question related to where the curve is going now. So basically, where do you see it going? Do you see it continuing rising exponentially, unlimitedly, or will it flatten out, or will it be a bell curve eventually? Because the context seems to be changing pretty fast right now. Since the 1950s, we've had a time of exponential growth in a lot of you know, GDP and other indices. Now we have some factors that seems to show otherwise. See a lot of negationism in terms of science. In Europe, the idea of union starts disappearing after everything that has happened, and not only in Belgium. So do we see this trend? Do you see this trend flattening out or inversing itself in the near future?
The analyses I've been giving you really talk about this distinctive period. They don't provide theoretical intellectual grounds to make projections. And you imagine that this is a very distinctive period, liberal hegemony in various ways. You know, there are a bunch of things one can say. And that some of that breaks down now. And you expect changes. What's been surprising to me is during these 50 or 60 years, the steady or monotonic character of so many of the changes that I look at, and the difficulty to explain them. But I don't have any reason to think, to argue forcefully that then continues in some fashion. The one, and you gave just tossed off a bunch of good examples. The one I'd take exception to a little is you mentioned Belgium. It would be natural in this system with the decline of the state for more, compared to the high period of the nation state, it would be very natural for regionalist separatisms to arise. You know, you do have in Europe a country called Slovenia, which is not able to defend itself very well, I don't think. And you can easily have a Catalonia. And you can have two parts to Belgium. And I mean, there are a couple of doctoral dissertations. I sit on committees. In one of them captures the rise of regionalism, legitimated, as you know, by the European Union and by international law, basically, international human rights law. So he studies several counties in eastern Poland, which have no history ever of having been a region of anything. But they can get money if they can work out something. And so they try to work out a little regional story. Now, Catalonia is well prepared for this. But another student I work with studies Extremadura, which has a history of being a depressed area, a regional history, but not an admirable one. Most of the people ran off to America. And they also do. So on the empirical question of Belgium, but your basic point, I think, is absolutely right. Yeah, that there's no reason to believe. And there are always competing themes at the edge of any normative system. And as you know, there are a bunch of competing themes. I mean, there are people who think Europe is Christian. Okay, good luck with that. You know, there are just endless alternative depictions of reality, and structural changes can make some of them come to the fore. So no, I'm not projecting a brave new world at all.
But in terms of number of organizations, is this going to continue multiplying to the infinite, or is there a maximum number of amount of organizations that the 6 billion human beings can handle? Because
I assume there are a number of limiting processes. One of which you didn't mention, that's the absorption one. At some point, the associations that protect some species of fish assemble into a big association that protects fish, right? And that's happened, especially with the rise of the World Environmental System. You want an organization big enough to function in Nairobi. So you get a consolidation and an expansion of the budgets of associations that make sense in this structural change, or given various cultural changes. The world ecosystemic movement legitimates the union of all sorts of radically disparate interests under a picture of a world ecosystem. That's an example. And those forces can, you know, limit change. And no, I wouldn't think there's a limit built around the logical number of people, but there are a lot of factors that affect that, which I have examples of, but no analysis of that's worth talking about. Yeah, Valerie. Yeah.
All these analyses are based on some formal definition of an organization, right? There is some database where they're registered. And now it's becoming easier and easier to register. Yeah. To move to France, I had to, within 2 minutes, register and get employer identification number to put a stamp on shipment. Because they don't allow to use social security numbers, so private individuals have to be, privacy has to be protected, right? So if you count all this, it can go exponentially unlimited. But of course, there is a limit of human energy. How active these organizations are going to be. Entrepreneurs create 10 organizations for each project. One of them maybe take off, right? So if you clean this data and kind of look who is active at each particular point of time, maybe it's not that many, actually, after all.
Well, a big fraction of them don't exist.
But
the point is that the whole number goes way up. And some of that is methodological in the sense that it's easier to do.
Yeah, no,
but I think it's reasonable that some go up. A good paper, unfortunately not published, is by a graduate student named Hannon at UCLA, who wanders around the streets of a secondary city in Malawi and finding that the international INGOs that say they are there are not in fact there. And a bunch of them are there that do not say they're there. And the government's list is even worse than the official one I have. And his list is probably the best one. He walked up in every main street and he did what he could to find them. And that they are forming and dying all the time. It is very easy to form. Now in his case, he's not making a communication argument only, but it turns out that they're all kind of rich Europeans and Americans who wander around the world wanting to do good. And the fishermen in Malawi find one of these on the street. And they say, I will make a school, and you have your own school. You come from Los Angeles, you can go home and show people the pictures of your school and the happy children and the good teacher. You know, this is going on all the time. He said, without benefit of the intervention of the church or of any state. Then I discover that you can go on the web and do volunteer work this way. You can just say, well, I feel like Guatemala this week. I will go to Guatemala, I will fix my Spanish, and I will volunteer for somebody I'd never met before. In other words, there are cultural elements there, there are communication elements there, and it's a dynamic thing, and my counting is awful. Oh boy, yeah, that's right. Yeah, the data are terrible, which is interesting. I very much agree with this point. And the point that that these actors, and remember, these are all university, the guy in Malawi who's ripping off money from the Los Angeles lawyer, these people are university people. The guy in Malawi has to know English. You know, he has to have gone to the university, or he has to be able to talk, world talk. That's what it is. So that I'm emphasizing those cultural factors, but there are a bunch of others, and the fragility of the whole system in overwhelming, yeah. Oh, yeah. Other issues?
Could I ask a different question?
Yeah, sure, yeah.
How can we test theories behind this, right? Because you need you have one case and this growth. Right? You need some variation. You need, let's say, by sector, by something, and say there's more legitimacy here, less legitimacy there. That's why here we have growth, here we have decline. Otherwise, and then the second point is why it's difficult to separate. It's not really independent factors, probably, right? As you said, it's kind of dynamic system. You start doing this, you gain legitimacy, you're doing more of this. So we need to really start thinking about dynamics of this and feedback. Sometimes this feedback takes place, sometimes it doesn't. So really, it's and what kind of propositions can we test based on this?
On your first formulation, there's a clear answer, but it's not too useful. That's a time series analysis with one case over time. And as you know, those are disastrous methodologically. I have done one that worked and was convincing, at least to a journal editor. It's published in International Organization in 1997 on the World Environmental System. A straight world-level time series analysis. Causal, you know, with causal structure. Pretty fragile. And as you know, those are terrible. I mean, those work in a stable system, and what we're talking about is a system that is everything but stable. And it's terrible. Other people do it with verbally. A verbal kind of time, and some of those are very convincing. When Nietzsche Berkovich writes a book, From Motherhood to Citizenship, before World War II, women enter world society, the discourse as mothers, things like that, prostitutes also. And then after World War II, individuals, equality. It's pretty convincing in a loose way as a historical qualitative time series analysis. Then you shift more radically into the second part of your question, which is, how do you study this? I don't think I've formulated my ideas clearly enough that I can think very well of. I'm in the middle of trying to write things about it, but trying to figure out how to formulate things, even so the formulation is clear. But what I'm really saying here is that these modern organizations are a dense system. Stanford University is surrounded by organizations that weren't there before. Voluntary organizations, legal organizations, state-based organizations. Everything they do comes up against another organization, and it's not come up against at the boundary, it's interpenetration. So the modern professional, when he works in an organization, reflects his professional loyalties. He may also, because he is an actor, a citizen, he may have his own love for raccoons, so he helps organize against the university, the Raccoon Protection Association. And that is both external and internal to the university. So the modern organization is less and less rational as it evolves to deal with all that, but evolves to incorporate that. That is to say, everybody in sight in a modern organization is disloyal. In California, I'm not familiar with Paris, I'm sorry. But in California, when you work in a modern Silicon Valley firm, you're supposed to have your own career in mind. You should be able to show up on Monday, do teamwork Tuesday through Thursday, and take a better job on Friday. You're supposed to do that. That's normative. And if you can't do that, maybe you're rigid, or maybe you're German or something. I mean, maybe they say things. I mean, you know, you have to be able to do that. You know, so, and that captures this sense in which extreme levels of interpenetration, where legal structures, informal structures, penetrate what looks like a formal organization. And so as we're in a world in which, as the accounting gets cleaner and cleaner and more elaborate, the reality in some other sense gets more and more unclear. I think about this now. Bear in mind, I can afford to do things like that. I'm not up for tenure. I've spent a lot of time looking at a pencil and thinking of all the different ways I can now fund that pencil in a modern organization. You know, this institute, this budget, the professional association budget. Leaving aside personal, the idea I would spend my own money to buy a pencil. I mean, all of them legitimated, all of them completely and tightly accounted for in the best traditions of modern accounting, right? It's all very clear in some abstract sense, but the actual decision of what it is completely unclear. This is high interpenetration. Multiple organizations involved in the same act, each of which giving the appearance of participatory rationality and actorhood. I don't know how to analyze that very well. It seems endemic.
Yeah, John, the cultural story is very powerful. And, you know, just to give an anecdotal illustration of the kind of role of accounting in that context. I mean, there's apparently a number of US business schools now that are reinventing the way to value professors. So basically they are counting the number of students that goes through a professor per year, putting some value on that student, plus adding some kind of fictional value to whatever publication is being done, etc. And then you have altogether what is the value created by that professor in the end. So this is a wonderful example of what you were saying. But I want now to push you on the power story behind, because this, we can, you know that I'm pushing you sometimes.
Yeah, yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, I've been here before, yeah.
So, you know, the level of the cultural story is very, very compelling. And, you know, I mean that. At the same time, the culture we're talking about is a particular culture. We can even call it an hegemony, in some sense, Western-type hegemony. So, how does the power dimension play there? How does the hegemonic dimension play there? And I guess it connects a bit with the question that Adrian asked a bit earlier about, you know, what happens next? What's kind of the next step? Because there is a clear, you know, origin to that culture story that you're talking about, and it's very specific, and it cleans up the other cultures, as you were saying, in a very nice way to mediate those other cultures. So, you know, can you tell us a bit more how you deal with this dimension, the more power hegemonic dimension in there?
I would distinguish, I don't use the word power very much because it is unclear who gains and who loses. I mean, the modern conceptions of power get rid of the idea of a power holder and turn power into something systemic, and I'm very nervous about that. Hegemony does make sense if you don't take too seriously the concept hegemon. It is certainly true that the whole process I've talked about is affected by the two features of world society, the astounding, the breakdown of the colonial system and the spread of norms of equality, and astounding centralization of resources, all of which centralize in basically Western content. And that produces a situation in which much emulation arises, and much of it voluntaristic. So hegemon in a loose sense, yeah, they're copying these models, and now the hegemon declines, or some parts of it decline, and you have the rise of alternatives, and you'd imagine that would change some dimensions of what I've talked about. It's hard to imagine a world in which, say, Japan had been successful in the 80s in coming to be more dominant, and then you'd have the same celebration of individual self-expression, you know, liberal American ideology. That might weaken. You might get a more welfare-oriented conception of the rights and powers of the individual. You could imagine lots of changes occurring with shifts in hegemony, I think, independent of the idea of power. Power can also apply, but I think, in the phenomena I'm talked about, power is, it's there in the straight sense, but it's not in the interest of the American national state to send me to Africa to do things on development projects. And my influence in Africa arises because of hegemony, but it's not much power. It's broader, it has a social influence, and you do see the operation of power, you know, straightforward exercises of power where some country has to do something because of dominating relation with another country. There's plenty of that in the world. But I don't think that accounts for this extraordinary explosion of emulation and of modernization, identification with the global world. I guess it's sociocultural process, and I think the word power doesn't help a lot. Inequality helps. That is to say, the people in the African countries I work in, they're very conscious of the fact that if their schools taught the child the local culture, he gets an income of $200 a year. If you can teach him to pass the test in English to move up, his expected lifetime income gets more toward $2,000 a year. It's a huge difference, like that. And they know that. And for this reason, they create schools teaching in English and teaching English, staffed by teachers who don't know English. And it's a disaster. Right? But they don't want the kid to learn to live in the local village and get $200 a year. So world inequality really enters there. And the whole process I've talked about, just think how much it would change if we had a world depression of 200 years. You know, a real serious depression, a decline to nothing. Obviously, the whole pattern would change. But I resist the word power to describe most of that. Especially because the whole form of the modern world system is voluntaristic. That's the formal, that's the structure in which it postures itself. And it certainly looks, when you work in the third world, like a voluntaristic process. In some of my interviewing in the backcountry of Botswana, I tried to get them to say they wanted local education for local society. And I bring all my weapons of imperial authority, my tie, my jacket, everything. But they resist. And one of them finally said, well, they could have 1 hour a week of local customs. He was willing to give up 1 hour a week. But other than that, he said, we want it to be like it is in Gaborone, the capital city, 400 miles away or something. Or another one said, like it is in your country. That's what we want. Another one thought for a while, and finally I forced him, and he said, well, the agricultural curriculum, the school, they could plant vegetables that grow in the sand up here. Mound is at the edge of the Okavango Delta, and the soil is pure sand. And some of the vegetables that the national curriculum has them plant don't grow in sand. So, yeah, they could adapt, yeah. That was as far as he'd go. But no, they don't. And now, naturally, you have other world, this is, goes back to the question of other models. In the post-World War II period, you have had other models. You have had more corporatist models coming in education from Germany, which retains a tripartite system and vocational training. And you had, in the early years, some Swedish ideas validating that localism linked to particular roots. And you can find the leftovers of some vocational programs produced by the Swedes to train the people in to produce their local baskets and their local textiles. Works okay with that, but it's very expensive. It costs twice as much to do, or 10 times as much to do that as it costs to run a regular school. And then the textiles that come out look strangely Swedish. So you have doubts about the validity of the localism involved. But I think the voluntarism of the system is overwhelming. That's the formal structure. And obviously, the causal analysis we'd all give involves notions of hegemony. Yeah, right.
One more question. So thank you very much, Don.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you.